students, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Welcome back to Amreena Mehraj Tutorials. My dear students, this video is basically meant for foundation class students. It's in the format of quick voice clips and I have attached a lot of images in order to make this video interesting for foundation class students. I'll help you finishing management of natural resource today. So let's get started. Before that, don't forget to like, share and subscribe to my channel so that I can reach to more learners. Dear students, this is your quick voice number one. In this quick voice, let us understand about deforestation. My dear students, deforestation simply means removal, or you can say cutting down of trees. So removal of trees from a particular forest cover is called deforestation. The effects of deforestation are disastrous. Number one effect is soil erosion. See, you know that these are the roots of the plant which hold the soil particles tightly. But when we cut down these trees, or when we remove, uproot these trees, soil becomes loosened. And this loosened soil can easily be eroded by winds and fast flowing water. So whenever there will be winds flowing, or whenever there will be rainfall, this deforested area, the land of this deforested area becomes prone to soil erosion. Okay, so consequently, erosion rate will be more in this particular area. When erosion will happen, there are definitely the chances of losing this topmost fertile part of the soil. Once we lose this topmost fertile soil, we are left with only sand particles. That means the fertility of the land is lost. If it continues in winter season as well as in summer season, there are chances that this fertile piece of land could be converted into a desert. That's called desertification. So you have some fertile piece of land being deforested, being cut down, and then you have the same area exposed to soil erosion, and the same area over a period of time, if the situation continues, it could be converted into a desert. So you can see the two effects: first, soil erosion, and desertification. Now the third effect is, like in such areas you will see that floods will happen regularly. Okay, so in rainy season, whenever rainfall will take place, since trees are not over there, if trees would have been there, the rainwater could have been holded by the soil, and that could have been capable of recharging underground water table. But trees are not there, consequently the areas which are lowlying areas, they will experience regular flooding. Okay, regular flooding will cause loss to the lives, that will cause loss to the agriculture and loss to the property of those people who live in those lowlying areas. So if you're cutting down forest in some mountain, it is going to affect the people. It is going to affect the life of the people which are living in lowlying areas, because they will experience floods regularly. Similarly, once you are cutting down the trees, what are you doing at the same time? You are eliminating the habitat of various wild animals. So once their habitat is destroyed, once the habitat of wild animals is destroyed, you are putting their lives in danger. Putting their life in danger, we are eliminating their natural habitat. They become more prone to get endangered, or either they can get extinct also. Okay, that is another scenario which will develop because of deforestation. Similarly, when forests are cut down, you will see that there will be change in regular pattern of rainfall. Okay, you will have unpredicted rainfalls. Summers will become more hot and winters will become more cool, because the reason is forests are not there which were regulating this water cycle in a normal situation. Consequently, the frequency of rainfall will decrease. You will have unpredicted rainfalls, but the time when rainfall was expected to happen, that will not happen. Okay, that will lay an impact on the quality of soil, and indirectly that's going to lay effect on every component of your environment. My dear students, do you know there was a lady called Amrita Devi Bishnoi, who along with 363 other people sacrificed her life for the protection of KG trees in Kirali village, which is in Jodhpur in Rajasthan. So this lady, along with 363 other people, in 1931 sacrificed her life just for the protection of wildlife, for the conservation of wildlife, for the protection of trees. She sacrificed her life.
Government of India has, created an award which is called Amrita Devi Bishnoi National Award. Every year this award is presented by Government of India to those people who do something extraordinary for the protection or conservation of wildlife. This is your pickwise number two. In this pickwise, now let us take up a movement which is called Chipko Andolan or Chipko Movement. Why Chipko? Because in this movement, people hug the trees. Now you can think, why people are hugging trees? Because they are preventing axemen or woodcutter or contractors from cutting down these trees. The purpose will be conservation of forests, definitely. Now, how did this movement start? It started in a remote village which is called Reni. The name of the village is Reni. It's in Garhwal, which is a Himalayan region. This movement started in 1970s. What happened in this village was women embraced the trees of the particular area, thus preventing the contractor who was supposed to cut down the trees. That means deforestation was going to happen in this area, but women prevented this deforestation. They actually circled, they embraced the trees, and that's why the axemen were unsuccessful in cutting down these trees. In this way, these women helped to prevent this act of deforestation. This happened in 1970s. This movement is called Chipko Movement or Chipko Andolan. Such movement was then started in 1972 in West Bengal also, where sal forests were prevented from deforestation. They were protected from deforestation rather by common people. They just went there and they hold the trees, they grasped the trees, preventing the woodcutters from cutting down these trees. So such movements must be encouraged by common people, because these movements conserve the environment, they protect the environment, and they make us realize that how important forests are. So what are the roles which are done by Chipko Andolan? What are the roles which are performed by Chipko Andolan? Definitely it helped in conservation and preservation of forests. Okay, it also helped the forest resources to get replenished over time, because they are not cut down, they are not destroyed, they are given the opportunity, the time to replenish the damaged part. Even this Andolan taught a lesson to the people. People understood that forest products remain available. Forests are very, very important, and if we damage the forests, it's indirectly going to affect us, and it's going to affect the quality of the soil and the quality of and resources of water also. So the damage is not going to be only to the forest. The damage is going to affect the living component as well as the non-living component of the environment. And even this Andolan encouraged the participation of common people, which helped more in the management of forests. So this Andolan was a successful movement. It was a successful Andolan. It made people realize how much forests are important to us. My dear students, Chipko Andolan or Chipko Movement was such a successful movement that it didn't remain confined to the Reni village. It slowly spread to the nearby areas. It spread under the leadership of Shri Sundarlal Bahuguna of Siliyara in Tehri region, which is also a Himalayan region, and Shri Chandi Prasad Bhatt of Gopeshwar. These two people, under the leadership of these two people, this movement spread to other areas also. Sundarlal Bahuguna is a world-known eminent figure. He was the person who presented his plan, his movement at United Nations Environment Programme, UNEP meeting held in London in June 1982. So you need to remember about these two people. One is Shri Sundarlal Bahuguna and another is Shri Chandi Prasad Bhatt. Sundarlal Bahuguna was from Siliyara and Chandi Prasad Bhatt was from Gopeshwar. These are also village areas. The most important name which you need to remember is Shri Sundarlal Bahuguna. Dear students, this is the third pickwise for the day. Now let us understand about water as a resource. First and foremost, we must not miss this opportunity to thank Almighty Allah. Alhamdulillah, 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 that Allah has provided us with this finest blessing, which is water. Water, without water, we cannot think of our lives. Water is the basic necessity for all living organisms which are there on this planet Earth. My dear students, if we have a region where water is scarce, where water is less available, those regions are related to acute poverty. So there is a connection between availability of water and poverty. That's why you can see that African countries are poor because they have scarcity of water. One reason for their poverty is less availability of water. Now, the second thing is, my dear students, that we human beings are so greedy that we are damaging this beautiful natural resource, that is water. We are over exploiting water resources, and we are considering them as a waste disposal site. We dispose domestic waste, factory waste, industrial wastes, as well as hospital and other commercial waste. We come up with those wastes and we discard them in a water body, considering it as a waste disposal site. But that is totally impractical and totally ingenuine and unacceptable on part of an educated community. Now, my dear students, you must think in this manner that if water is not available in a proper quantity, there will be loss of vegetation cover, obviously. And if water is not available in a good quantity, then we are supposed to diverge a lot of water to the high demanding crops. See, we have certain crops like we have rice. It's a high water demanding crop. Under normal situation, if water would have been available in a normal proportion, there was not a problem in cultivating rice. But when already water is scarce, when already we have lesser availability of drinkable water, potable water, under those circumstances we are supposed to diverge more water towards these high water demanding crops, which is further reducing the availability of this water for general population for daily purposes. Okay, even you will see that because of the pollution caused to the water due to industrial effluents and due to urban wastes, you will see that the quality of the water is getting damaged day by day, is becoming poor day by day. And this is going to lay impact on overall environment. Look, if water won't be available over there, vegetation cover will be lost. If vegetation cover will be lost, the consequences will be similar to that of deforestation. If vegetation will be lost, it will be a scenario similar to deforestation. Consequently, you will have soil erosion, you will have desertification, you will experience frequent floods, and you will experience climate change. See, it's interconnected. In this case, you are damaging quality of water, you are overexploiting water resource, vegetation will be lost. Once vegetation will be lost, you will be facing consequences similar to that of deforestation. So now, what is the remedy? What we are supposed to do? We are supposed to immediately reduce the reduction of wastage of water. We have to reduce the wastage of water, be it at domestic level, be it at industrial level. We have to reduce pollution of water, be it domestic pollution, be it industrial pollution. We have to think of different irrigation methods. Okay, we have to think, or we have to devise suitable irrigation methods, like we can construct dams and tanks in which we can store water for some particular period of time, ensuring that water will remain available for irrigational purposes. Although the construction of dam is not an eco-friendly process, during the construction there will be certain damages done to the forest, done to the particular area where the dam will be constructed. But we have to think of these alternative techniques if we want to continue our lives on the surface of the earth, but that too in an eco-friendly manner. So if we want to construct a dam, we have to put different criteria under consideration. Now, my dear students, let us understand about dams further. What is a dam? You know, a dam is basically a large reservoir. It's a large body in which we store a large amount of water. Okay, so this stored water is then allowed to flow in downward direction at a rate which we want. Either the rate of flowing of water will be high or low, that is managed by we people at what rate we want the water to flow from the dam. Now, what is it this dam used for? Dams are used majorly for irrigational purposes, okay? In different seasons of the year, maybe sometime water will be available, sometimes water will not be available. So how can we ensure the availability of water for irrigation? We can construct this dam on a river. We construct this dam so that once the water flow in the river is high, this water will be stored in this large storage region, which is called dam, so that whenever there will be scarcity of water, water will be released from the dam for the irrigational purposes. So water from a dam is basically used for what? It's used for irrigation in fields. Now, water will be released by means of certain canals. So certain canals are constructed then through which water will run to the particular irrigational area. Okay. Now, another advantage of dam is that it supplies water not only for irrigational purposes, it supplies water to the people which are living in towns and cities through pipelines. We can transport water to those towns and cities also, so that this water could be used for drinking and other domestic activities. Similarly, there is yet another advantage of this dam, which is very important. That is the production of hydroelectric steam. We can use this fast flowing water, which is running down from the dam. We can use this water to rotate a turbine that could be connected with a generator, which can convert this mechanical energy into an electrical energy. That's very, very important. Such products are called hydroelectric projects, or they are called mega projects, because we generate hydroelectric steam by the construction of a dam. Now, look how many advantages the dam has. It is used for irrigation. It's used for getting drinking water. It's used for generating this hydroelectric steam, which is very, very important for running our factories or maybe lightening up our homes and all. Wherever we require electricity, we can use it. But there are disadvantages of dams also. So big dams were actually created with the purpose of providing economic benefit to the people and to the nation. But unfortunately, it has been realized now that the construction of big dams has posed a lot of threat, a lot of negative effect on environment. Let me make you understand. The biggest problem is the social problem. Social problems arise because of the construction of dams, because a large number of people which were actually living in a particular area for years, maybe hundreds of years, maybe for generations, maybe for 10 to 20 generations, they have lived in that particular area. But now that area needs to be cleared so that the dam could be constructed. Especially we are talking about the tribal areas, hilly tribal areas where dams are constructed. The people which are living in those areas are to be dislocated. They are dislocated. They are supposed to leave their homes, and government then promises them that they will provide them alternative homes in maybe cities and towns. But those promises are not met. The people are dislocated without any sort of rehabilitation. Isn't this a social problem? Isn't this a big social problem? Isn't this an issue? So dam was to be generated so that the people will be benefited. But here you saw that there is a negative effect of this dam. Social problems are arising. In the same time, you will see that for the construction of the dam, a lot of the vegetation, a lot of the plant cover is to be removed. Once you remove this vegetation, what are you causing? You're causing environmental problems, because you're doing deforestation. You are damaging habitat of wild animals. We are doing loss to the biological diversity. Isn't that an environmental problem? But we have to do it because we want to construct the dam. On one side, we want to get a benefit, but on another side, we are causing environmental problem. The third important thing is the economical problem. See, for the construction of the large dam, what is needed? A large amount of money is needed. And where from this money will come? How? Think where from this money will come. It has to come from the tax which government collects from the common people. So this is going to be the public money. So public money is used for the construction of dams. But proportionately, we are not getting the benefit of the dam. Common people is not getting the benefit of the dam. Common people is getting a negative effect, because common people is dislocated from its original position without getting any proper compensation. That's why we say it results in economic problems. So we have social, political, economic, we have environmental problems arising from the construction of the dams. So we also have to keep under consideration that the mismanagement of these dams is causing exploitation of the resources, and even there is no equitable distribution. Equitably, this water is not used. Then politics comes into play, and the water which is there in the dam is exploited by those people who have political support. So then in any case, all the times there is a non-equitable distribution of this particular resource, which results in imbalance in a particular society. Students, in order to find out the rest part of the video, you are supposed to watch the third part of Management of Natural Resources. Take care. Allah Hafiz.